Welcome back. A judge-alone trial is underway in New Zealand for the White Island volcano eruption that claimed the lives of 22 people, including more than a dozen Australians in 2019.
For more, TVNZ reporter Sam Kelway joins us now from Whakatane. Sam, good morning to you. What more can you tell us?
Morena, Carl. Morena, Sarah. Yeah, well, this is a big day. Obviously, the trial was supposed to start yesterday. We had the Whakatau, so I'm not sure if you're familiar with that in Australia, but it's a bit like a porphyry, a welcome, a greeting. It's slightly less formal, but it was quite beautiful. I'm not sure if you saw it in Australia, but singing and song, and I guess the judge really wanted to show the importance of this trial and the fact that it is getting underway after 2.5 years.
It has taken so long. I mean, this disaster happened nearly 4 years ago. Is there a particular reason WorkSafe has taken so long for their investigation or the previous inquiries to it now to get to court?
Yeah, absolutely. Remember, the charges were laid about a year after the eruption, so it's been about a 2.5 year process, and 13 individuals and organisations were charged. So you had tour operators, you had the owners of the island, and since then, in the pre-trial hearings, we've had numerous organisations who have pleaded guilty. The latest, in fact, just on Friday, 3 helicopter companies pleaded guilty. So the judge said he wanted a little bit more time, so the trial will start today, but he wanted WorkSafe to amend some of its case because obviously we were supposed to have 13 defendants, we've just had 6. But this is it's the biggest investigation that WorkSafe has ever launched in the history of WorkSafe since it started. So a huge investigation. Obviously for Australia it's hugely important as well because you had so many tourists that were here. It's important for the community, and of course it's important to New Zealand as well to ensure that those who were responsible are held to account.
I wonder, I mean, it's so difficult to even look back at that vision, and we're very mindful of the fact that for all those who did survive, it's like torture looking back on what happened. What are families hoping for in terms of punishment here, and what happens?
Yeah, Carl, that's a really good question, and it probably depends on which country you're asking it. For Australians, I'm sure they would want some punishment and consequences. For some people here in New Zealand, that island, I mean, just off the coast here, it was a source of income for the local economy, for people who flew out there every day and took visitors out there. It's a hugely important island. But then you also heard from some local tangata whenua, so the Māori here, that they don't want to look at the island anymore. So it really depends on who you're asking, but you can imagine that, look, we've already had White Island Tours who's pleaded guilty. They face fines of up to $1.5 million. You've had others who have pleaded guilty. They'll find probably fines in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. Different to, I guess, the states where you might have a legal case where they can sue for big money. But it really does depend on who you're asking and what country you're in.
Yeah, the laws are certainly complex in New Zealand, especially around this kind of adventure tourism. All right, thanks so much for your insight. Appreciate it.
Right now, a trial into New Zealand's White Island eruption is underway in Auckland, nearly 4 years after the tragedy, which claimed the lives of 22 people, including more than a dozen Australians. Helicopter pilot Mark Law joins us now from Whakatane. Mark, thank you so much for your time. What must be a difficult period for you. You and 3 colleagues flew into harm's way to rescue people stuck on the island. You also received a bravery award for what you did. Are you able to talk us through how you're feeling at the moment?
The day has finally arrived for the families and the survivors of that tragic day. It's also a day for the remaining entities who have been caught up with the trial. So it's a mixed feeling day. I think we're all really acknowledged that it's specifically for the families and the survivors, and now it's their time to be heard, the trial to take place.
What was it like for you that day?
The day was It started. My call to the island was because of a friend of mine who had his helicopter on the island, and he knew that it was still there through the eruption, and he had his pilot plus four. So I said, "Yeah, okay, I'll head out there and have a look and see if we can find them and you know help them." So myself and one of the other, we took another helicopter. Two of our pilots, we flew out there. And on the way out there, I started to realise that there was probably more than just the helicopter that was on the island, and that we're potentially just looking for five people. So once I got there and flew inside the crater and started flying around, I quickly identified what looked like a person lying in the ash, and then my eyes tuned in and I saw numerous people. And then it dawned on me that we had a real situation here.
I can't imagine how difficult that was for you. Tours were operating. This is part of the trial. Tours were operating despite the volcanic alert being level two, the highest level it could be without an eruption. And your company, I think, has pleaded guilty to doing that. Why were they flying at level two?
Yeah, good question. And the question is one that a lot of people have asked. Very clearly, one and two is where we operated. We operated there after a lot of consultation between ourselves and others and listening to GNS, which is the government organisation that manages volcanoes in New Zealand. And those two levels there were levels that we deemed safe enough to undertake tours to the island. The real issue of those levels is it's just one to two, two to three. There's no amber light, you know, and so, you know, you can be green, 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 then red. And it's such a difficult thing, the science of, you know, volcanology and predicting eruptions and things. So we, you know, believe that we were doing the right thing, listening to GNS, working with those levels. But, you know, you can see clearly and it was apparent, and it happened, obviously, that the move from a two to three was, you know, seconds to a minute.
What do you hope comes from all of this? It's such a difficult and tragic and awful story. What do you and others hope will come from this?
A couple of things, Carl. First of all, that the trial takes place as fairly and as openly as possible, with the right information getting tested and judged. Secondly, that the volcanology and particularly its inclusion with the likes of ourselves, tourists and other users is able to be managed in a way that gives us a lot more knowledge of the potential, and that can be done by, you know, the definitions being drawn out. You know, instead of one, two, three, you might have one, two, three, four, five, and to replace a one to two. Thirdly, that risk can be managed and all reasonably practical. That some people actually do really, really well at managing risk as best that they can, and that if something goes wrong, it's not, you know, defaulted that they are actually a criminal.
All right, Mark, I appreciate you sharing your story this morning. Your heroism on that day cannot be denied. We wish you all the very best. Thank you.
Yeah,
Sarah. No, thanks,
Carl. Work undoubtedly saved lives that awful, awful day.